Good evening, everyone. My name is Hamid Dabashi. I'm Hagop, Kevorkian Professor of Iranian Studies and Comparative Literature here at Columbia University. On behalf of all my colleagues here at Columbia, but particularly our host School of the Arts, I would like to welcome you all from wherever you are joining us. I hope you're happy, healthy, keeping social distancing, putting your masks on. And if you're like me, you're over 65, you have received your first shot of the vaccine. I would like to begin by thanking our co-presenters, Columbia Alumni Association, Columbia Global Centers, and the Film Program and the Office of Public Program and Engagement and the School of the Arts. I would like particularly to thank my dear friend and distinguished colleague, Carol Becker, Dean of Columbia University School of the Arts. And I would like to mention that this particular conversation that we have tonight is part of our School of the Arts 2020 and 2021 season of public programming on the theme of repair. You can go on our website and learn more about this. And I am here, not just as in my capacity as a great fan of the School of the Arts. Many of my colleagues, James Chambers, Richard Pena, Annette Insdorf, Carol Becker, Jane Gaines, Dan Kleinman, but particularly because of my close connection to Ramin Bahrani, the distinguished member of our faculty, and also whose spectacular, successful film, White Tiger, is now tonight is the subject of our conversation. I would like to begin by formally introducing Ramin. I have known Ramin most of his adult life, but it is absolutely my pleasure to introduce him formally tonight to our conversation. Ramin Bahrani is Associate Professor of Professional Practice and Head of the Directing Concentration in the Film Program of Columbia University School of the Arts. He is the Iranian-American writer, director, and producer of the Netflix feature film, The White Tiger, based on the Man Booker Prize-winning novel. The film debuted as number one in 64 countries as the internationally renowned, award-winning writer, director, producer of critically acclaimed films, including Man Push Cart, Chop Shop, Goodbye Solo, At Any Price, and 99 Homes, legendary film critic Roger Ebert proclaimed Bahrani as, quote, the director of the decade in 2010. All of Bahrani's earlier film features and short films have made their world premieres at the Venice International Film Festival and the Cannes Film Festival, garnering a number of prizes. He is a Guggenheim Fellowship winner, has been the subject of retrospective around the world, and his cinematic oeuvre is housed in the permanent collection of the Museum of Modern Arts here in New York City. For television, Bahrani's HBO film, Fahrenheit 451, starring Michael B. Jordan and Michael Shannon, was nominated for 5 Emmys, including Best TV Movies, and earned a PGA Award for Best Television Film. Most recently, Bahrani produced Alexander Morato's Brazilian debut feature, Socrates, which won a dozen international prizes and garnered 3 Spirit Awards nominations in 2019. Currently, Ramin is producing Morato's new untitled film for Netflix, starring Rodrigo Santoro and Alex Camilleri's debut feature, Lotso, Malta, which premiered to great acclaim at the 2021 Sundance Film Festival. It is my pleasure now to welcome Ramin to our conversation.
Hamid, hi.
Hey, man.
I know you said all that, but when I see you, I just see my teacher, my mentor, and my friend.
It is so absolutely both pleasure to talk to you publicly, but also a little weird because you and I talk almost incessantly.
It sounded like you were talking about an alien.
Me too. But
I was waiting for you to say, come by and have a wine and dinner and we would talk.
Listen, nevertheless, nevertheless, it's a night of celebration of your magnificent achievement. I'm absolutely honored and delighted to have just been by your side, all of this that happened. Now, as you know, tonight we're here to celebrate the spectacular success of White Tiger. But I thought we begin a little bit sort of upstream from White Tiger and come forward. And I want to share with our audience something peculiar in our relationship, which is you and I talk about your films mostly when you're getting ready with an idea, that you have an idea, you're writing the script, and we constantly talk until you have a draft and you send it to me and I read it, we converse, we talk, and so forth, until you start shooting. When you start shooting, you disappear into thin air, I disappear into thin air, I don't know what you're doing, until you have the first draft ready. And then we get together, we watch it, we discuss, cut this and that, until the premiere night. When the premiere night go with her and we celebrate, I thought, that's it. We never talk about that film and just move on to the next film. I mean, partially is both you and I are workaholic. But tonight I thought, Ramin, we go back quickly, because much of the attention should be on White Tiger, and rightly so, because White Tiger is you in perfect form. I think everything you have done so far was coming to culmination in White Tiger. As I said, I was just watching it last night again, just, cold, just to get ready for this. So I want to run by you, Ramin, a scenario of how your of cinematic career began with Man Push Cart, and see if we can come up with, you know, some sort of a trajectory of how did it how did you come here. Man Push Cart, you remember when it came out, I thought it is the best 9/11 film that has nothing to do with 9/11. It's just a Pakistani impoverished Pakistani immigrant who is pushing his cart as a Sisyphus pushing a boulder. We don't see him in the company of a father or a mother or even a friend. He's just very solitary figure. Until we get to your second film, to Chop Shop. Here we are in the presence of a little boy, Alejandro, and his sister. Again, no sign of any parents or of any significance. And the two brothers and sisters are together. And from then on, when we move to Goodbye Solo, and we are with this character, the Senegalese cab driver, who is providing for his family, until he meets this older man that becomes William, which becomes like a father figure for him, who wants to commit suicide, doesn't happen, and is ambiguous. Finally, when we come to your next feature, At Any Price, we are in the presence of a father and son relationship. And your preoccupation is, of course, with farming and the rest of it. The height of that, despite the fact that many people continue to adore the Chop Shop, but there is a trajectory in the rest of your films when we get to 99 Homes. Here, the relationship between Dennis Nash and Rick Carver becomes a kind of a tumultuous relationship between a father figure and a son figure. And eventually, the criminality of all of this anticipates, I think, what happens in White Tiger, sort of master-slave relationship. One short film that people who know you know the film, but I absolutely adore, is your black plastic bag, which is so abstract and is so beautiful I mean, we're talking about inanimate object, but nevertheless it assumes a character. Until we get to Fahrenheit 951. Now, 451. Now, in Fahrenheit, obviously, we were watching it in the context of Trump's election and concern about fascism, but it's still the relationship between the Montag character and the Beatty character is a bizarre father-son relationship that has its own ups and downs, which now that brings me into your adaptation of Aravind Adiga's White Tiger, which now you're completely in the domain of master-slave relationships, both love and hate relationship, ambition and resentment. If you kind of bear with me of this quick trajectory that maps out the way your major features have been unfolding over the last, I think, decade or so. Do you, at this point, by the time you finished White Tiger, do you see a trajectory of your entirety of the body of your work that will guide you for the rest of your filmmaking? Or do you think there is some sort of an epistemic shift happening? Where do you see this, you know, the whole history of your filmmaking so far, and this film that by all indications, it is the most spectacular success of your cinematic career so far?
That's a hard one to answer. I never thought about the father, son, master, slave. I guess because maybe in some of those films, I'm not even sure it was father and son. In some of them it was, like At Any Price, but in some of them it seemed like, I don't know, East of Eden or some twisted older brother, younger brother, you know, like with Rick Carver and Dennis Nash, because their age difference was even just 5-10 years, it really seemed like, when I thought about them later, they seemed like one character broken in half, you know, that one character was going to the extreme place that was inside the other character, but that character was not capable of getting to, or wasn't ready to go there. That kind of push and pull that I think a lot of us can feel when you're trying to survive or achieve something in a very morally complex world, where in order to achieve anything, in order to get somewhere, you may have to make compromise decisions. I mean, in some of that, it's just flat out greed. And in other times, it's just wanting to survive, like the which I think we understand now in different ways because of COVID, the more and more people understanding that we're one paycheck away from being homeless or one illness away from total financial ruin. And when you feel that and you get to the reality of that, then, you know, I'd rather have bread than morality, right? Going back to Dostoevsky, right? Give them bread before you give them morality. So I think that specific concept from Dostoevsky was always, I think, in a lot of the films. I mean, we've talked about that before. You and I have, at least. I don't know where everything is going. I get, these days I keep talking to you or texting you or talking to anyone I can find about like a mission, you know, how can the work continue to be a part of what I see as some mission or some vision of focusing on these kinds of characters that are typically not seen in movies, voices that are typically not heard. Kind of the crippling impact of globalization or economic forces, all those things, and how they bring us to, you know, challenging moral decisions. I it seems to be what continues to occupy me, even thinking about Arvind's new book, Amnesty, which I'm going to do for Netflix. Even that has similar themes again in it, immigrant character, moral conflict. It's hard to imagine those kinds of themes not being there. I don't know if that answers the...
It does. I mean, it's beginning. I want the audience to get to know your relationship with literature. You just mentioned Dostoevsky. But let me first remind the audience that they can use the Q&A to ask questions, and eventually we will feed in your questions to Ramin. So you will be part of the conversation. It would be good for the audience to know how close your relationship with literature is, especially with classics. I read somewhere that Aravind said when you made Man Push Cart, you inaugurated two careers, both your own career and his career. And I know you read the novel White Tiger while it was being written. You're a very literate filmmaker. Dostoevsky is very important to you. Camus is very important to you. Do you think at this stage, your sort of literary provenance is set, or are you still discovering new poetries? I know you always are interested in Persian poetry or European novels or American fiction, or do you think you're set with literature and it is your cinematic career that carries you?
No, I mean, I think, I don't know how you feel, but I kind of think those works of literature and those films that preoccupied me, let's say from age 15 until 30 something, it's kind of, I don't really understand how to shake those away from the core foundation of my thinking and my vision. I don't know how to do that. Some people have that ability, like Malcolm X, who was able to reinvent himself 3-4 times. That I find that kind of person astounding, like that concept, which some of that I feel even in White Tiger, his ability to want to change himself or who he is. You know, a lot of the, some of my introduction to new literature probably comes from my partner, Marlise. You know, she's a very avid reader. She's reading, you know, 50, 60 books a year, and certain things that don't really come, wouldn't come across my table. But returning to the same books is often helpful. You know, reading some of the classics you're mentioning, or Steinbeck, you know, every 10 years you find so many new things in them. But I think something about the White Tiger that I'm interested in was the trying to cinematically capture the tone of the novel. What Arvin wrote was so brilliant and so different. It had such a unique tone that didn't match any of my work. So that it was kind of thematically very similar to my previous films, but stylistically was different. And I'm interested in continuing to try to pursue that, to see, can I tackle similar themes, but in a different way? I'm interested in that at the moment, to see if that, where that would lead me.
Ramin, let's talk a little bit about the way you work with actors. You're very much a character director. And you have moved from working with complete amateurs, kids off the street, to working with Priyanka Chopra most recently and other professional actors. Could you, and then you come from sort of Kiarostami, Naderi tradition of working with non-professionals. Could you talk a little bit about the difference in this regard? That do you feel more in control when you're working with a non-professional, or equally at control when working with professionals? Are there variations in your directorial habits and practices?
I mean, some of the strategies and techniques of working with non-professionals really helped me with, I feel, with professionally trained actors. You know, basic simple things that I started to do on the first film, like don't say action, don't say cut, I just don't say them. It seemed like foreign concepts to a non-actor, and it didn't seem necessary, and I wanted them to be more themselves, to blend the reality with the acting. So that idea of not saying action and cut, I kept even with the professionals. The idea of learning about the non-actors so that I could weave in their character into the script and know them, that I maintain with the professionals. I try to get to know who they are so that I have a better understanding of how to talk to them, so I can try and get a certain performance or get them emotionally somewhere.
Go ahead.
There was a looseness that you need with non-actors. You can't expect them to just do certain things. So the idea that an actor could kind of do whatever they wanted, or that you might shoot, like in Man Push Card, in a live environment that you're not in control of, you know, that forces you in a very good way, that you and the camera becomes malleable to the actor, that I have the shots in my mind and I know where the camera should be, but I'm prepared to change those things for the actor so that the performance would be at the front and center of the story. And so those same strategies get used for me still now with the professional actors. I don't really tell them where they have to go or what they have to do. If you cast them well and talk about things prior, you can kind of let them loose on set and let them roam around. You know, you open up the doors and the bull comes out and goes wherever it feels like. And you encourage that. You encourage them to find things, to search for things. And then I rearrange myself if I have to accordingly. Mm-hmm. So there are scenes in White Tiger that are shot in live environments, like a ballroom when he's accosted by this beggar who wants, she wants food and money. And he yells at her and starts to pull his shirt and put his wallet in her face. This is all improvisation in a live environment where no one really knows what the actor is going to do. He came to me and said, I'm going to try to do this thing, which he always told me. He said, can I improvise this thing? And he would try to tell me, and I would always tell him, don't tell me, please don't tell me. I want to watch it for the first time like an audience. Just do it. Believe me, we will figure it out on our own. Like the camera will figure out what to do. And in that scene, the only direction I gave the beggar woman, who was the only other actor in the scene, was whatever he does, which I don't know what it's going to be, please just say, can I have money? I'm hungry. Mm-hmm. No matter what he does. And then the rest of the people there who don't seem to care to look into the camera, they're just so interested in this servant yelling in the street, they don't pay any attention to us. And he just did it. And I love that moment. And that concept really comes from working with the non-actors.
Exactly. Ramin, that's a good time to, Netflix has given us two short clips. That's a good time to introduce one of them. If we could please see the clip about, are there computers in villages?
Oh, right, okay.
I'm so sorry, I have half-baked and teeth brushing. Which of those
is? Yes, half-baked.
Hey, could you turn around for me for a second?
Yes.
No. That's not what I meant. Just stand here. I feel like your back.
I'm ashamed to admit it now. But in that moment, I thought Mr. Ashok's wife, Pinky Madam, was one of those women.
Oh, I'm so sorry. I didn't even introduce myself. Hi, I'm Pinky. Nice to meet you.
Honey. All right. I need to talk to him.
All right.
I need to talk to him.
Okay.
So, driver, we're both. I'm sorry. What's your name?
Sir Balram, sir.
Balram. Yeah, Balram. So, Balram, do you know what the internet is?
No, sir. But I could drive to the market right now, sir, and get as many as you want.
Nah, it's okay. Thank you. Do you have Facebook?
Yes, sir. Books. I always loved books, sir.
Yeah, I heard you can read. Have you ever seen a computer?
Yes, sir. Actually, we had many of them in the village with the goats.
Goats?
Yes, sir.
The goats are pretty advanced to use computers.
I could tell from their faces. I had made a mistake.
Pinky, you see, he's got 2-3 years schooling in him. He can't read and write, but he doesn't get what he's read. He's half-baked.
Okay, now you're being a jerk. He's standing right
not,
there.
I'm not being a jerk.
Come on, Ashok.
You're missing the point here, Pinky. Our driver represents the biggest untapped market in India, waiting to surf the web, buy a cell phone, rise up into middle class. Something I can help him do. You're the new India, Balram.
I am the new India, sir.
So, Ramin, two questions, if you could talk about this scene. One is this strategic and absolutely punctilious introduction of the voiceover. How did you manage the synchronization of voiceover and actual dialogue? Second, the shooting inside a room, the camera is part of the conversation and requires a certain kind of familiarity. After all, you're from Winston-Salem, out in Delhi in this strange home. This your familiarity with the space and the camera with the space. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, I mean, the voiceover, this was all in Arvind's novel. It's a first person narration. So, and part of what's so amazing about the novel is the voice of Balram. It's so sarcastic and funny, and his perception and his observations are so unique and so specific to who he is and where he's from. And I knew I could never lose that, or it wouldn't be The White Tiger, it would be just some movie. So it was the first time I made a movie with voiceover. And part of it was studying old films that I loved, like with voiceover specifically, like Jules et Jim or Fight Club, Goodfellas. The way they use voiceover, including the idea that in middle of a scene, I had to make time and space for him to think something before another character spoke. That's used in other scenes too. So that was all the first time I had ever done that. But, you know, I think it worked out, and I think just kind of really by going, looking at some other films that did it well. The locations, I like locations a lot. I mean, one of my favorite parts of making a movie, of preparing a movie, is finding the locations. So I always think that casting the actors and casting the locations are the most important things you can do. If you've done those well, you can kind of get by with everything else, you know? And so casting of locations is really important to me. And I try to spend as much time as I can in prep in those locations so that I can conceive of how to shoot the scenes by physically being there, mm-hmm. as opposed to, you know, being in my room somewhere alone and thinking and imagining. I admire directors who can do that, but I have to be there, you know?
Exactly. But I want, Ramin, to ask you to talk about exterior shots, because interior shots doesn't make a difference if you're in New York and Delhi is an interior shot. What is very impressive about White Tiger is frequency of exterior shots, daytime exterior shots, which requires sort of physical familiarity with the space, which after all is not your hometown. I mean, New York is your hometown. Winston-Salem is your hometown. You have shot in Florida. You have shot in rural America. Was it in any way, but I know you went location scouting, there are many sort of preparatory stages that is not evident and shouldn't be evident in the final product. But could you talk a little bit about the mechanics of how you get to become part of the space and be at home in the space before you start shooting, especially the exterior shots?
Well, it's really just spending time. I mean, I felt, and I've heard people from the West who go to India talk about, you know, their initial reaction to being overwhelmed and whatnot. I understand Iran and India are not the same. Of course they're not. The number of people is just so incredibly vast in India, and there's so many more cultures and religions and languages, but still there are some similarities, you know. It didn't feel as foreign to me as it might to someone else. That I think really helped. And the rest of it is spending time, you know, going there. Part of it, one of Arvind's, you know, real suggestions was to try and travel as much as you can by foot to certain places, walk them. Don't just get in the car, walk around. And so I wrote down all the locations in the novel, even if I wasn't actually filming those scenes. If the scenes were not in the script, I still tried to visit everywhere he wrote in the novel and travel them by foot and look around and take photos and observe and try and capture that, because it's an epic story, you know? So you're trying to capture a wide array of looks to show his journey from villager to big city. I mean, even the final sequences in Bangalore, you're making sure you don't film big glass buildings until the very end so that it feels like he's gone into the future. Like the idea of filming an escalator, that happened because in a location scout, I saw the escalator and I said, my God, imagine this kid from the village with the water buffalo one day in his life would be on this escalator. You know, to me, it reminded me of stories from my dad who grew up in Borazjun in a small village, like the one we see in The White Tiger. Instead of water buffalo, he had donkey, but basically the rest of it was the same. And I remember growing up with those stories about when my dad would say he remembered, you know, flicking a switch when he was 6 or 7 and suddenly miraculously a light turned on. Or when he went on, saw an escalator in America for the first time and couldn't understand how do you get on that. So seeing that escalator and remembering that story from my dad from his growing up in a village, I said, oh, this should be in the movie. Or watching Balram count the balconies because he's never seen a building this tall. Again, I can remember my dad telling me when he went from Borazjun to Shiraz and saw a tall building, how strange that was. So I think all those things helped incorporate the landscape with the story and the actor.
Good. Let me now shift from sort of, you're absolutely correct, physical proximity between Iran and India and perhaps even other places. But what about, you know, you're a great admirer of Satyajit Roy. Was Indian cinema of the period of Satyajit Roy, Apu trilogy and things of that sort in your mind, thinking of them? Were you nervous, happy, excited that you are in Satyajit Roy's neighborhood?
Well, certainly we talked a lot about it with Tess Joseph, the casting director, who's from Calcutta. She was from his hometown and where his studio and his house and everything was. You know, Ray had a big mark on me, the same as Kiarostami and other directors. I remember I was at Columbia University in the 90s when, I don't even know if we've really formally said it, you were my professor, and I studied Middle Eastern cinema with you and Persian literature with you, and you became my mentor when I was a undergraduate at Columbia University in the 90s. That's when our, let's say, teacher-student relationship started, and then we became friends and big brother, and you're the cook and make the meals. And
but I didn't want to center stage myself. This is your night.
So many of the things I learned came from the discussions we had over the course of 25 years. And it was at that time when I was a student with you that the Scorsese re-released a 9 restored Ray films at the Lincoln Plaza Cinema on 63rd. And so we would go down there and watch them and then come back and talk. So every 2 weeks there was a new Ray film. I of course, it's always in your mind, those films that impact you from that early period of being influenced by cinema. When I was there, I think Arvind's novel it's so modern and it's so subversive. It's so, even in its concept of family, it's like an anti-Ray. It sets family as a trap of some sort, which is kind of flipping a lot of stuff upside down. So I was more looking in more modern concepts, you know, cinematically, things like the Decalogue 5, a short film about killing, that was interesting to me. Goodfellas was interesting because of its epic scope and its ability to take us into worlds we don't know, and narration and all that. Yeah.
Ramin, there is another clip that I want to share and then ask you to talk about your relationship with your DP.
Okay.
This is a very good shot, both in terms of mise-en-scène, lighting, camera movement. If we could please see, watch the shot with the toothbrush.
Why had my father never told me not to scratch my groin? Why had he never taught me to brush my teeth? Why had he raised me to live like such an animal? If only a man could spit his past out so easily. You ask me to explain how one event connects to another, or how one motive strengthens or weakens the next, I'll tell you I don't understand these things. I should warn you, my story gets much darker from here.
Yes. Ramin, could you talk a little bit about your relationship with your DP? Who was he? How did you guys work together? Things of that sort.
Yeah. The cinematographer's name was Paolo Carnera. He was one of the 3 or 4 people that came outside of India to make the movie. The crew was 99% Indian. He was one of the very few people I brought. He's an Italian veteran DP. Can you believe his first job in the camera department in Italy was on a Fellini movie? So he was up in the rafters somewhere and Fellini told him to move a light. It's incredible to think about that. Yeah, really incredible. And I really liked his work. I had discovered his work in a few places, in a TV series and in some feature films he had done. And so we worked together on a TV pilot once, almost as a testing run to see if I would bring him to India. And we really clicked. And he did an amazing job because he's so good in lighting and creating mood and atmosphere, you know? So for in those sequences in that garage where he lives, we were talking a lot about kind of ugly lighting, you know, sometimes yellowish or kind of ugly purples, or in this case, bare bulbs. And he was just fantastic to work with. We tried to make different look for each part of the movie. So the village had one look, it was handheld. Even when it was on a dolly, it was handheld. It had a 16 millimeter grain to it. When he gets to that rich villa Donbad, we shot on wide lenses, on dolly, on Steadicam, but very wide. So we would see the actor in this glorious, you know, white castle with this palm trees everywhere, very different from the village. And then in Delhi was about changing upstairs, downstairs, you know, making sure the rich upstairs was one way and the downstairs another way. And then, you know, in his time as an entrepreneur, it was about really confident and aggressive steady cam movements and dolly shots that expressed the power that character had and the energy he had and the confidence he had. So there was a lot of movement to express that. Another moment I like a lot that he and I talked a lot about, it took us a long time to get to that point, is the murder sequence itself. Because initially we both thought it would just be a handheld, very intimate, visceral moment. But then at a certain point, I told him I wanted a wide shot on a medium lens at 96 frames a second, which is slow motion, but very slow-mo, with the rain coming. And that my intention, as I described to him, was that I wanted it to feel and look epic so that we would shift from the personal and visceral between Balram and Ashok, which is the handheld part, to this wide shot that would become not about a Ashok and Balram, but about master and servant, about rich and poor, that it would be about a centuries long battle. And we would remove ourselves from the personal and go into the abstract and the epic. That was my hope with that shot in that moment.
In addition to your cinematographer, India has a magnificent cinema industry. How much of your crew did you have Indian crew for you in
Valley? Yeah, all Indian. I had Paolo and 2-3 people in his team. I brought one production designer who had to accept in the beginning. I told him, I don't want you to bring anyone on with you, just everyone should be from there. And that was it. So the crew on set was 99% Indian, except for these four or five people. So the costume designer, the set dresser, the sound mixer, the casting director, the production team, the lighting designer, the rub, the grips, they were all Indian. It was the only film I made where I looked around and everybody kind of looked like me, you know? That had never happened in America. So it was a pretty interesting feeling, you know?
We're all delighted that the film is so spectacularly successful, particularly in India. I mean, it just, yeah, the numbers are going through the roof. Priyanka Chopra, no doubt, has something to do with it. But in my opinion, the way you get acting from her and other actors is simply spectacular. But to what do you attribute yourself, I mean, in this particular time, over the last 2-3 weeks that the film has been out, this phenomenal success of number one in 64 countries? How do you read that?
I don't know. I mean, it's been seen by about 30 million people, which is like, let's say 29 million more than my six other movies combined. I don't know.
Well, one is COVID. We are all in quarantine. We can't do anything. We just sit home and watch.
Maybe. But I mean, you know what? When the novel came out, they said, oh, it's successful because of the financial crisis. Now, is it? I don't know. I think that story that Aravind wrote was so powerful. That character was so unique. His journey was so unpredictable and electric, and it was always a step ahead, and it was always, he somehow turned all your expectations at all time in the opposite direction. I don't know, really. Maybe people are kind of sick and tired of the idea that there's a happy ending to all this, mm-hmm. you know, or that things will work out in some magical way, and they were ready for something a little bit more of a killer in the last second. I don't know.
Yeah, let me remind the audience that we will shortly turn to your Q&A. You will be part of this conversation. BAFTA nominations came out, as you know, and White Tiger is nominated for just across the board, director of this film, etc. How do you assess, Ramin, in your own, most of your films were premiered in Venice or in Cannes or now in BAFTA. Do you detect a difference between sort of Asian market, if we were to take India as a location, and European context and the North American context? Do you see any difference?
Yeah, I do. I mean, I think that within the Western world, still this kind of a film is an oddity. You know, the way Parasite is still an oddity, it's an unusual thing that happens. But what's interesting, what I'm still trying to wrap my head around because it's so new, is the concept of a global streamer like Netflix, where suddenly making a movie in India with an entirely Indian cast, 25% in Hindi, and it doesn't star Tom Hanks or Brad Pitt or George Clooney, it suddenly, maybe it means more. Maybe more people would see it, actually.
Well, partially, you know, I mean, the issue is, I mean, I see your point about Western world and non-Western world, etc. That, as you well know, with various civil rights movements and women's rights movements and anti-fascist movements in the United States, we have a third world inside the first world as well. So there is a market for this kind of film that is no longer limited to outside the kind of the industry that picks and chooses certain films to celebrate and not so, and especially because this is an English language film, India, the language is English. Let me shift to another point before we break for conversation with our audience, which is how free or limited you felt were working with Aravind's novel. You have known the novel before it was published. The novel is dedicated to you. You know the author, you know the text inside out. Were there moments that in the translation of the novel into the film, you felt that you need to do something else?
Yeah, I mean, Aravind was very generous. He said that I could do whatever I wanted with the book. He said it would be the first of my screenplays. He didn't want to read. He wanted me to feel free to do what I wanted. But for me, I really wanted to try to maintain the tone of the film. I wanted to try to maintain the basic ideas and concepts of the film. There were certain things that I didn't know how to translate into the screen. You know, there's some major changes in the novel and the film structurally. Like in the novel, in the very end of the first chapter, Balram announces to the world, "I cut my master's throat." You know it right off the bat. And in the movie, we hid that information until it happened. So that was kind of one of the biggest changes that it took myself a while to wrap my head around that, because I had never imagined that it would be any other way. There's some wilder things in the novel that didn't make it into the film. There's probably 25 minutes of scenes that I filmed and I had to cut out because either I didn't think they were good enough or the film was just getting too long. I mean, right now it's about 2 hours with about 5 minutes of credits. So I just kept trimming the movie at the end, including cutting scenes I liked, but eventually you have to do that, I guess. It was a weird experience having to edit the movie because it was COVID. And starting in March, I was editing alone in a room, and the other people in the editing team were in their own homes. No one would see each other anymore. And normally, you know how it is. I would call you and you would come to the edit room, or I would go to your home and I would watch you watch the movie. Or I would invite other people 2-3 people, and I would watch them watch the movie so that I could feel some of their energy, and you can understand what's funny, what's not, where is it boring, where is it too fast, what did they not understand. I had no opportunity to do that this time. All I could do, and you remember, I sent you a link.
Yeah.
And then you called me on the phone a few days later, which is helpful, but it's not having that opportunity. You're kind of just taking your best guess. I to this day, I have not seen the movie with other people, which is such a weird experience.
I mean, just like this very conversation, ordinarily after this conversation, Carol will take us out to dinner and but now after this, nothing. It's just anticlimactic.
Yeah.
Let me now go to, there were some wonderful questions, Ramin, that is coming to us from our audience. I want to read some of them to you. This is from Joe. I really enjoyed what you had to say about the about you being malleable to the actors and their improvisations, and that creating unexpected and meaningful moments like the street scene with the beggar. Is there a moment you can think of when someone in the art department or costume department or any design department similarly contributed something unexpected or that wouldn't immediately be noticed by the viewer that you adapted to and felt really contributed to the success of the scene?
Wow, what an amazingly detailed question that I feel I will not answer appropriately. But I like the question a lot. I mean, one thing that we try to do is, I don't know if this will answer it, but I always like to try to ask the actors what they think and what they imagine. So with Balram, we asked him, what do you imagine is going to be in your office when you're successful in Bangalore? And he gave us all kinds of ideas, and they were all interesting. Like he wanted, you see it in the scene actually, he wanted a painting of water buffaloes in the pond from his childhood.
Oh, wow.
And he wanted a sketch of his father, like he had asked somebody, he wanted it to be as if he had asked someone he met who could draw when he was successful. He would describe what his father looked like and that person would draw it for him. And both those images are in the movie. So I like that. You know, in terms of the other things, I don't know. They all did. I'd have to think about it. I don't know.
Here's another good question from David Shofi. How much direction was needed for the lead role? He seemed so incredibly in the part.
Yeah, he's amazing. If you met him, you would be more amazed because he's nothing like the person in the movie. He would be here with a cool, stylish haircut, and he's a young, hip guy. So that, I think, would make it more amazing. There were chances to cast lots of people for that part, famous diaspora actors that you know and I love, famous Bollywood actors, but I wanted an unknown by the end. The more time I spent there, the more I thought this character should be from India, hopefully an unknown. And Adarsh was amazing. It's his first leading role. He'd gone to the full scholarship best acting school in India. He really put himself into the part. He went to a village and lived there anonymously for a few weeks. He got a job in a tea shop. And worked there for 100 rupees a day, which is like a nickel for 12 hours a day of work. And one time I called him, I texted him on the phone, by the phone. I said, I need you to come to the office for a callback, like with another actor. But he didn't know what to do because he was at his job washing the dishes. So he told the boss, I got to get some bananas for the cafe. So he ran to get the bananas and just kept running and running and running until he got to the office. And this was the amazing part, Hamid. The next day, he went into the street looking for another job, which he was trying to do without his identification card. He kept introducing himself as Balram. So he's wandering around Delhi, and some men said, hey, you, come here, come here. And he goes there, and there's some men loading metal into a truck. And they said, start putting this metal into the truck. They didn't ask him if he wanted to. They didn't ask him, was he looking for a job? They just said, do it. Exactly. And he did it. He did it.
He looked the part, yeah.
He looked the part. So he had become, somehow he had become Balram. And this, he was amazing, you know. I asked him one time, how would you walk as a servant? And then how would you walk as a master when you're an entrepreneur?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
1 week later, he came to me and said, I want to audition 12 walks for you as a servant.
Unbelievable.
And he did, and we picked one.
Jesus Christ. Here's another good question, Ramin. Why did you choose to have a narrator as outside voice as a core aspect of the film? What are you trying to accomplish with the narrator?
Well, this is Balram's voice. It's his movie. It's his story. The purpose of using it is really just because it's the way the book was written. The book is a first-person narration, and I love the book, and I love all his observations and his sarcastic remarks, and I thought the movie would be much smaller and less entertaining and less funny and less thoughtful without it. Even this scene where he's brushing his teeth, it would be nothing without, for me, it would be nothing without that amazing dialogue that Aravind Adiga wrote in the novel. Like I love that moment, Hamid, because he's becoming aware that he's poor. I don't think he fully realized it until that moment, what it meant to grow up poor. And he doesn't like that feeling. And the next line always moved me when I read the book, which is he says, if only a man could spit his past out so easily.
Yeah,
I just thought, don't we all know that feeling that we feel somehow potentially trapped by our past or our background? And I thought it was so profoundly moving that without the voiceover, what would it be? You know?
Here is another good question from Joy Fairbanks. Please tell us about how you came to develop the final scene, which breaks down the third wall. He means fourth wall. It was very powerful.
Oh yeah, thank you. Honestly, I got lucky in the moment. I love that scene because Hamid, I feel Aravind upended Dostoevsky in that moment, because in Crime and Punishment, right? He in the end of the novel, Raskolnikov is,
yeah,
confessing his crime, but more so he's crying to Sonya with his heart and confessing to God for his sin, because he has the nightmares of what he did. But in The White Tiger, the nightmare is that he didn't do it, that he didn't kill that man, that he's still a servant to another man. And I found that so radical, the idea from the novel, and so amazing and so modern. Yeah. And so in the novel, he's thinking these things, but I decided to visualize it, that he's telling his drivers. I honestly can't tell you if he's really telling them or if it's just in his head. I don't know if it matters, but I don't know really which one it is. I thought the scene would have a lot of shots because it's a 1.5 minutes and he's talking to so many people. But when we did the blocking and picked up the Steadicam and we just looked at it one time, it almost was one shot. And so I finessed a few things, moved the people here, moved them there, moved the camera, and suddenly it was one shot. And then we realized if we just back up and I tell the men to spread out a little bit, there would be a wall of servants kind of confronting the camera. And it was just kind of incredible the way it unfolded when we were watching it and messing around. And it just seemed like for the viewers, audience members' comment, there was something memorable about it. It felt iconic. It felt like it had so much meaning in it, you know, and a bit punk rock that it's grabbing at you like, hey, you know, watch out. Don't fuck around with the seamless driver.
Speaking of Raskolnikov, you remember, Ramin, when I was a member of the jury in St. Petersburg, I went to the neighborhood where...
You sent me the pictures.
Yeah, where Dostoevsky was plotting and where Marmeladov was, Raskolnikov went.
You sent me a picture of the bridge where he throws the jewelry.
Exactly, yeah. Sonia is thinking of suicide. Here's a sort of a political question, but related to your film, from Daniel Palmer. Can you speak to the role that China plays in the story and dialogues in the film about the decline of American global power? Does this relate to the shift you spoke about, how cinema is created and distributed today?
In a way, maybe it does. I mean, this is again from the novel. Aravind was pretty prescient, he was ahead. And you know, I started reading rough drafts in 2004. He had probably finished it 2006-07, it came out in 2008. And at that point, even prior to the financial crisis, I think the novel was predicting and saying that the West was on a gradual decline and that China and India were booming. So in the novel, he is writing this email to Wen Jiabao, and Hamid, it was so weird, I didn't want to lose it. When else am I going to make a movie where the main character is writing an email to Wen Jiabao? This will never happen again. So I thought I had to do it. And I like that it decentered the West. I like that it destabilized certain people. I remember showing it to a filmmaker friend, a white Western filmmaker friend, who wrote me a note back and said, "Don't you think we would connect more to the main character's voiceover if it was just to us, not to Wen Jiabao?" And I remember I didn't answer him directly. I just said, "I'll think about it." What I really wanted to say was, "What do you mean by us? You mean you." And he's not talking to you. He's talking to that, in his own words, the yellow man in China. And when you say us, I think you only mean you, and that's not the rest of the world. And I think I liked what I interpreted from his comment was he felt destabilized, and I liked that. Why did he think he was the center of the world? Because he was white and from the West. It didn't make any sense to me. And so I think it was good to keep it. And yeah, I think global distribution of cinema is changing what could be seen and what could be seen by masses of people. I'm getting emails from people, and I mean, still to this day, in Mexico, in Bolivia, in Zimbabwe, in Greece, in so many countries, telling me that it felt like the movie had been made in their country or in their home.
There is also something, Ramin, again, we have talked about this, about our kind of a spatial and physical relationship to cinema. You know, when we were kids, I mean, you're much older than you. You're used to VHS and CDs and such. But for us, cinema was also all on the screen, and we were just sitting here and dwarfed by this. But right now, I get my iPad, and I kind of look at it like this. The physical relationship with film and art has changed. I have a wonderful question here about where did the question go? About here it is. Michelle Mirsky. How did you reconcile the India that you depict and how Westerners think about India? And then additionally, fabulous film and amazing book. Well, I mean, beginning with the novel itself, it blows this saffron smelling color of India out of the waters with the way he writes. But the question is, if this was also an issue for you, I mean, I was thinking of Satyajit Roy, but there is another conception of India that is at issue. The question is, how did you reconcile between the two?
I didn't think about it in those terms. I took the novel as my guide. And when you look at the novel, basic conceptions, romantic conceptions of India are either not there or they're being made fun of. You know, they're being flipped upside down. And so I just followed that as my guide. Like when he says, are we just, you know, humble and spiritual people? No, we're trapped in a rooster coop. That's great, because as you were indicating, I think in the West, people think, oh, they bow and they're humble, they're servant, they're spiritual, they do yoga, they go for a dip in the river Ganga, and they're enlightened. But I think Arvind was just threw all that in the trash. And so I just followed what was in the novel and figured people, maybe honestly, Hamid, maybe even now more than when the novel was written, people can relate to it because everything seems so twisted, you know, at all times. Like all over the world, people seem so mistrustful of everything. They don't believe any of the romantic notions anymore. Maybe in a frightening way now, they're only believing the opposite extremes. It could also be fabrications.
I forget where I read, Ramin, that somebody in praise of your film said, I just watched Ramin Bahrani's White Tiger and I'm scared witless of my own driver. I mean, I was not Indian, was an American, doesn't make difference, which means resonates with the question of the massive income discrepancy and what is happening right now in the United States. Another technical question from Valerie Pyrus. Mr. Bahrani, please talk about how you came across the novel. I mean, we know that, but I think it's good for you to talk about this, The White Tiger, and the process of adapting it into screenplay.
Yeah, as we mentioned before, the the novelist is a good friend of mine since the mid-90s. I gave him many of my screenplays to read for feedback, and he would give me manuscripts to read for feedback. And so I had been reading rough drafts of the novel since 2004. So I that's how I came to know about it. And, you know, adapting it, some of the biggest challenges were just cutting things. You know, I loved everything in the novel, so it was difficult to cut. And I think using voiceover narration for the first time was an interesting challenge. I kind of enjoyed it. And then there's a lot of scenes, Hamid. It's a movie with like over 200 scenes. Normally my feature film would have 100 scenes. So there's a lot of short scenes, little scenes that are connected either by music or by voiceover. That was a challenge in the writing and in the filmmaking, but I kind of liked it. It was fun. I can't say I'm a fun person, Hamid, as you know, but I had fun making the movie, weirdly. I never had so much fun making a movie. I enjoyed it. I think because of the actors who I liked a lot, and they liked each other, the three actors, the main actors. And it's a fun book to read despite its serious subject matter. It's kind of fast and fun. And I thought if I didn't enjoy making it, you wouldn't enjoy watching it. That was kind of a good lesson. I think I should try to enjoy the filmmaking more.
Here is a question from Willem, a general process question. As a writer and director of films, what do you prefer? A great day of writing as opposed to a great day of shooting?
Oh, a great day of shooting, I think. I don't enjoy the writing as much as the shooting. I mean, the shooting has its own pressure and tension because there's so many people with so many questions at all times, and there's so many problems that keep happening. And there's not a lot of time. You're compressing it into a short amount of time because it's expensive to do, but the writing has its own challenges. It's just really hard. Honestly, my favorite parts are dealing with the actors, working with the actors, and then editing. I think these are some of my favorite parts.
Mm. A question from Zahin Das. Are there any feelings in the filmmaking that you might not have been able to achieve with a Hollywood team? In other words, does working beyond the American industry bring access to a wider range of artistry?
Yeah, I think, you know, some of the feedback I've gotten from India and from Indians is that they felt it was very authentic, maybe more than a lot of the other films they've seen. And I think some of that is due to the novel, and I think a lot of it's due to the crew being Indian. You know, they could see things, they could tell me things. If something wasn't right, somebody would tell me. You know, I think it added a layer of authenticity and creativity that would have been pretty different otherwise. It would have been too many outsiders looking at something instead of people from the inside showing us. So I think that really made a really positive impact on the film.
Mm. There's a question about Hindi and as opposed to English. How did you choose between writing using dialogues in Hindi as opposed to English?
That's a pretty complicated one because the novel was written in English. But, you know, all the stuff in the village we assumed should be in Hindi because they wouldn't speak English. The servants talked to one another in Hindi because most of them wouldn't know English. Honestly, I would say probably Balram would have spoke more in Hindi, and although it's written in English, the novel, you understand his English is not as good in the novel as it is in the film. So we had to twist that a little bit. We gave him an English book that he's studying and whatnot. It was just that probably could have been a little bit more Hindi, but we tried our best with that.
Somebody is asking, what significance does the blackbird in the scene with Balram on a short play?
Yes, the crow.
Yeah,
it's in the novel. And I always thought it was so weird and amazing that in the middle of this fight between these two men, physical fight, a crow lands on the balcony and caws, and they look at it and then the fight ends. I don't know exactly what it means, but I thought it was so, it always stayed in my mind, that moment. There's a lot of animals in the film. You know, Balram comes from a village, so he's surrounded by animals at all times. So he imagines things in those terms. He latches on to those ideas of animals. He talks about people as if they're animals. And I cannot tell you the exact meaning of it, but it just always stayed in my head. So I thought if I put it in the film, it would stay in your head too.
Yeah. Ramin, could you talk a little bit about at what point, because you have known the novel from its conception to its various gestations, at what point you decided and told Aravind that you wanted to turn it into a film?
It was about five years ago, we were talking on the phone. We usually talk once or twice a week. And the idea just came up, what about making it? And it seemed like a good time to do it. He was interested in it. I was interested in doing it. I had always wanted to do it, but when he expressed interest in it happening, I felt more confident that it was good to do it. And in a way, maybe the world caught up. I think it would have been impossible to make the film at this scale, financial and scale of the movie in 2008, because who would have financed it? Who would have financed this book in 2008? I don't think anyone would have done that. And in 2008, I don't think creatively I would have known how to make the movie. I didn't have the growth as a filmmaker yet to know how to do this kind of stuff, the tone of it.
What about the new novel, Amnesty, that you're going to also turn
into? Oh, yeah. It's a great novel. Arvind's latest novel, Amnesty, which came out in March. It was on a lot of top 10 lists at the end of the year. I've been reading it for about 4 or 5 years. That was one that when he first told me the idea, I remember saying, oh, that sounds like a movie to me. And so I had always thought it would be a good one for a movie. It's about a Sri Lankan immigrant in Australia, an illegal immigrant who cleans homes for a living. And one day he hears about a murder, and the murder is of a woman whose home he used to clean. And he feels he knows who the murderer is. It's a man she was having an affair with. And they were both a bit unstable, a bit unhinged, especially the man. He could sometimes be violent. And so the main character is wondering over the course of one day, 8 hours in a cat and mouse game with that man, do I turn him in? Because if I do, he may say that I'm an illegal and I would be deported or sent to that horrible island off the coast of Australia.
So you plan to shoot in Australia?
Yeah. So it's really, does a person who has no rights in this world have moral duty or not? That's kind of the question, I think.
One other question about adaptation. If you could change the ending and rewrite it, would you have done it in the same way?
Yeah, the scene that is currently the ending is not the ending of the novel. The ending of the novel is, it's close. It's like a few pages away from the ending. The ending of the novel is actually the scene where he's at the laptop saying he would still, even if they caught him, he wouldn't regret doing what he did because he would want to know what it was like not to be a servant. That's actually the ending. I just shuffled them around in the edit room because that final shot felt like an ending. No, I wouldn't change anything.
I see. We have a question from Mimi Rich. How challenging is it to do production on the streets of India? Can you easily get permits, shut down the streets? I mean, especially with Priyanka Chopra, I suppose it was a nightmare, no?
The scenes with Priyanka Chopra were challenging to give some of the audience may not know a scope of it. If we shot with her anywhere, there could be a mob, the likes of which the security and the police said they couldn't control, they couldn't manage. Yeah. So like when we shot at the shopping mall, all she has to do is get out of a car and go inside. That's it. It was very difficult to convince them that we could do this because they thought that there would be a mob. So we finally had to do it at maybe 6 a.m. or something like that. And very quickly, because social media, people come, they hear. Other scenes shooting in the street, what I learned probably a few weeks too late, and when I did learn it, I was happy to finally have gotten it. You can't force things in India. It's not, in America, you can plan and pre-plan and you pre-produce it all. You have everything organized, all your ducks in a row. In India, it's a bit more go with the flow. And so it's better to go in that direction. And you don't want too much control anyway, because you want all that life coming and going around you. That's part of what's the great part of shooting there, you know?
Well, as I'm sure you know, our friend and distinguished colleague, Mira Nair, has mastered this beginning with her brilliant masterpiece, Salam Bombay, that of how to place the camera in a way that is not intrusive.
Yes.
Were you watching her in any sort of different way while you were shooting or about to start shooting?
No, of course, I love Salam Bombay. As I mentioned, I was really mainly looking at, as I said, Goodfellas, Decalogue by Kieslowski, number one and number five, and occasionally Taxi Driver. Mainly, I looked at a few of those things, honestly.
I have a question from my colleague, Michael Fishman. The question is this: as a director and editor, while you were directing scenes, did you ever make unexpected adjustments for anticipated editing purposes? And then saying it's a wonderful film.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I mean,
he's my colleague in the department, but he's also a filmmaker.
Oh, okay. Yeah. You know, I've edited, it's my seventh movie. I've edited four of them alone and three of them with another editor. So here I was working with Tim Strito. He would edit in one area and I would edit in another room. And then we did remotely because of COVID. I'm usually thinking of the edit while I'm shooting to make sure that if I needed something or if I wanted to get something. In this case, Hamid, the more than getting an additional shot, I was thinking more about the camera movement and how the weird pan or the strange movement would help me with the rhythm and the cutting. So there was a lot more movement than I would do in the past. And again, it was for tonal reasons. It was sometimes for tension and sometimes for fun, for enjoy. So that I think, like the novel, you can get into hard stuff, but with some enjoyment. So a lot of the editing and for me in this one was movement.
Mm. Ramin, have you ever had a Kubrick moment in post-production? Suddenly you realize you need a shot, like in Shining?
I had Tim editing in New York and he while I was shooting. So he knew to call me if there was a problem. And he did call me one time. I mean, I'm pretty happy in 60 days, he only called me once. And he said, I think you have missed one shot of Priyanka for a scene. And he was right. And it was just, we were still in the same, it was in the apartment complex. We had moved to the basement. So they had to reset up a chair for her and we had to get one shot of her. So I missed one shot.
But you didn't have to, I mean, you were still there and you could
shoot. We were still there, we went and got it. And it's in the movie, we used it. The Kubrick Hamid was the opening of the film.
Oh yeah, okay, you're right.
Do you remember the Clockwork Orange?
Yes.
You remember there's a montage of three Christs there's three images of Christ statue with his arm around each other. And he shoots all these different close-ups and angles of that. And it's cut very fast to Beethoven. That's what that opening, the Dandi March, the statue of Gandhi, which is in the novel. That's what that opening for me was about, those shots, was that kind of energy and that kind of playful spirit around Gandhi, which is somehow looking at the movie in a few scenes.
I can't help, Ramin, thinking if the late Kiarostami was still with us, how proud of you he would be. I remember when you premiered Chop Shop in Cannes, he was there in the audience watching the film with you and then getting up and hugging you and kissing you. And you became incredibly depressed and called me and said, I'm coming home. What is left after this? I shoot my film and Kiarostami, give me a hug. What else do I do? But something in Kiarostami continues to live with you and in you. I think we still have some time. Let me see if there are any questions that I have missed. Let's see. Oh, did you, has your crew and other people around the production seen the film? In the sense that other than, you know, Netflix sort of global release, has there been any specific reaction in India of a specific audience that would interest you and for you to know, you know, how
well, they have- the, I know that I FaceTimed with a lot of the production went to watch the movie in some sort of COVID safe way. I don't know how, like they were, it was a weird, you know, everyone with a mask, they were far apart. And I was able to FaceTime them a little bit. And many of the crew members emailed me or texted me that they were happy and liked the film. They were happy with the work. Mainly, you know, the film has been on Netflix in India. It's been the number one movie since it was released until now. So they must be liking it. And again, we can't do what we want to do with COVID. I wanted to go there, be there. I wanted to watch it with an Indian audience. I wanted to watch it in the village that we shot in. You know, you wanted to stage like an outdoor screening there for people, but you can't do any of it now. You're just waiting, and who knows, maybe in next year you can go and do that.
Of course.
Yeah.
There's a question here from Seth. Westerners who want to learn more about India can't all afford the time and money to hop on a plane and learn firsthand. We rely on novels and films. What about this film is particularly educational, representative about India for Westerners to pay attention to and take away? Any thought about that?
Well, I think it's all there. I mean, we tried to be as specific as possible with all the details, including the pond, you know. Yeah, I think it's all there, I hope.
Here is a good question from Anaya Banerjee. Which themes from the book, if any, did you feel didn't make it to the film?
Oh, yeah.
What was the reasoning behind cutting Balram's interaction with the blonde, quote unquote?
That's exactly what I was going to talk about. Yeah. I shot it. For people who don't know the novel, in the novel, the Ashok character, the master character, in his depression because his wife has left, he is kind of wrangled into sleeping with a white-skinned, blonde-haired prostitute that looks like Kim Basinger, which is somehow very funny in the novel, the way he writes it. And later then, Balram raises his money and wants to do the same. He doesn't want to sleep with a local, he wants to sleep with a foreign woman, a blonde-haired, white-skinned woman. And he goes to do that and he fails to do it because he realizes that the woman's hair is dyed, it's not really blonde, and he gets into a fight and he ends up not having an encounter with her. And then later, and I filmed all these scenes, Hamid, but they turned out pretty good, but not great. And the movie was becoming just way too long. It started to feel like a digression that works beautifully in the novel, but in a movie, too many digressions start to feel like you're not focused on where you're going. So we ended up cutting it out of the film. There's a callback to it later, and you may or may not even notice it. There's a scene in a bar where he's drinking a Johnny Walker Black, and he notices an Indian woman on the other side of the bar. If you look, there's a bunch of white people there. And this is a callback to that scene where he says he doesn't go for white women anymore because they're emaciated and don't have bellies. Their bellies are puny. And so there was some kind of a sarcasm and ridiculing of skin whitening cream and this kind of obsession over white skin and blonde hair in the novel that we shot it, but there was just no room. I wish we could have had it, but the movie was getting too long. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That perhaps I think I have one more question, time for one more question. That raises the question of pace. The pace of the novel has its own rhythm and syncopation and so forth. And then it takes a while for you as the director and co-editor and all of that, and for viewer to get into the speed and the rhythm of the film. How did you come up with that? How was the rhythm of cutting and pacing?
It took the longest time to edit this movie than of any of my movies. Honestly, we were editing from January until November. I mean, I always thought I was done, and then I would always go back and do more, where I would get a note that I'd never thought of or a feedback I hadn't heard before and I would be interested in it. It took a long time to edit because there's so many scenes, and especially the second half after Pinky Madam leaves until the end, I found that I could rearrange some of the scenes and it could still work. It could work in so many different ways. And you were trying to find a way to get him to the murder and make sure that you believed he was on that journey to get there without shortchanging anything. Because one of the things that was, I thought so interesting in the novel was that even after he's been betrayed by his master, he still can't help but be a servant to him. He doesn't turn away from him immediately. And I noticed sometimes in the feedback, some people would be like, well, he's been betrayed in that forced confession. Why doesn't he just kill him right then? But his mind is still stuck and he's stuck in mental servitude. It's been calcified into his bones. And that's not so easy to shake off. The same way he says, if only a man could spit his past out so easily. I think we must know this emotion, Hamid, where we are conscious of things we're doing and we want to change them, we want to correct them, but we simply continue on our day and our months and our years and we're still repeating the same things without being able to get out of that trap. In our own lives right now, here and as both of us, anyone in the audience. And so I wanted to have some moment where he's struggling to get out of that trap.
There's a question from one of the audience that is, I'm going to sort of turn it around a little bit, which is, you know, Pinky Madam speaks with an American accent. And there is a question of generations of first generation, second generation, of not just Indian Americans, any hyphenated American, with which one of these two characters would they identify, with Balram or with Pinky Madam?
Yeah.
Have you thoughts on that?
I mean, Pinky Madam, it's the novel, in the novel, Pinky Madam and Ashok are a little less developed because it's so much from Balram's head. It's just what he glimpses of them, which works, I think works beautifully in the book. In the movie, I had to develop them a little bit more because I have to tell the actors what their motivations are and why they're there, and they have their own lives and their own interests. And so Pinky Madam came to be living in the Jackson Heights from the age of 12. And I think it was interesting. I think some people identify or find Pinky Madam as a way into the film if they're non-Indian. They find her as a way to go in there, which I don't mind because she seems very woke. And I think many people can identify with her wanting to treat Balram well and not liking when they treat him poorly. And that's okay because then suddenly the person they've identified with smashes into a kid, kills him and flees the country and leaves Balram with like $5 in a package, in an envelope. So I think that's good too because we all have so much to think about, me too, about where we are in the world and the people around us.
It has been an absolute pleasure to talk to you. We're running out of time. And I am reminded to tell our audience who have been gracious and patient that there is an opening space for a chat feature in the webinar. If they wish to continue to chat, the organizers would love to hear from you. And as you all know, Ramin's White Tiger is available to watch on Netflix if you haven't seen it. I envy you. You are up for a beautiful experience. And I'm also reminded to thank once again the sponsors, the co-presenters, Columbia Alumni Association, Columbia Global Centers, and the Film Program, and the Office of Public Programs and Engagement of the School of the Arts. And once again, to my dear friend and distinguished colleague, Carol Becker, Dean Becker. Carol, you and I didn't do bad with Ramin, did we? Ramin, John, I want to thank you for giving us this extraordinary privilege of sharing you with public, talking about your most recent and a spectacular film. And I, for one, am extremely proud of you and honored by your friendship and continued conversation that we have almost incessantly. And I very much hope that we will have other public occasions to talk to each other. Thank you.
Hamid, thank you so much. I want to thank you. And I learned so much from you and want to thank also the school, the university, and of course, Carol, who supported me so much, and all my colleagues in the film program, all the writers, directors, and producers, my colleagues who I learned so much from and who've been so supportive and are all wonderful filmmakers, and want to thank you, Hamid, again.
My pleasure.
You taught me everything. Thank you, my man.
Oh, you, my man. Take good care.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.